baby. You wasted FBI time trying to cut a deal for yourself, and 7 agents were killed. This conversation now takes place on our terms. Adrian Lavelle and Hector Alvarez are still out there. You and I both know the only way you protect that child is to disappear.
And if I don't?
They'll find you. Both of you.
You're just gonna vanish?
You put her with good people. Keep her safe. If there's trouble, you let me know.
You must have known I'd find her.
The secret's out.
What do they want?
Revenge. They're using her to get to me.
What's your plan?
She needs protection right now.
Who are you?
From here on, you do everything I say.
You're driving.
I'm 12.
Let's go.
I hate it here. I want to go home.
Not till you know how to survive. Everything it takes.
You're scaring me. Every time I look at you, I'm scared.
Look at the mess you made.
You're not getting away this time.
You burned down our entire world for her.
Yes. I'm a killer. But I'm also a mother. And I will die protecting her.
Hey everybody, welcome to Ready Speaker. I'm your host, Roland LaRucci. You just saw a trailer for The Mother. It's a new film on Netflix for 2023 with Jennifer Lopez, Lucy Paez, Omari Hardwick, directed by Nikki Caro. Writers are Misha Green, Andrea Berloff, Peter Craig, some other actors in this, Joseph Fiennes. You have Paul Rossi, you have Gael Garcia Bernal, and a whole bunch of other people you might recognize from other films. But it's a busy little film with a lot of characters, sort of wide range setting, but narrow story. And that's probably my biggest takeaway with this film. It's actually a very narrow story, even though it tries to be a big story. And sometimes that works, sometimes it doesn't. I'll give you the full rundown of the show. Jennifer Lopez's character, the mother, I don't think they even mention her name, that's how she is in the credits. She's an exceptional soldier in Afghanistan or wherever the hell it was, and multiple tours. And she gets singled out by a consultant, a British consultant, played by Joseph Fiennes, who takes her under his wing to sell arms illegally after the war. Because as she said, what was she going to be? A cashier, which is wrong. Because in the military, you can do multiple tours. You can get consultant jobs. There's so many ways to make money if you're really, really good at something. And I think that's like kind of the dumbest easy way out, which is, you know, a tropey thing for in a lot of military movies. Like, they're so good, but they're just tired of it. And she's not tired of it. She hurts people in this, and that's what she was good at, supposedly. She's taking the jump into action movies, I think, with this. Tired of the romantic comedies or romantic movies. She's been, I think this is her second Netflix within the last year or so. This is set in the wilds of the U.S., I think Alaska at some point, up and trying to isolate herself and get away. She turns on Joseph Fiennes and a gentleman named Hector, and both gentlemen were dating her at the time of the start of the story, where she decided that she wasn't going to do anything illegal anymore, and she was going to do the right thing because she saw it and everybody else turned a blind eye to it. So almost like superpowers, which I don't really like. She has a child that's 12 years old now. His daughter is kind of like weird and, you know, complainy and does stupid things, which I think is something I've mentioned before. I'm tired of that as well, where kids are just that ignorant. You know, they're in the wild and just saying stupid things, and they're trying to do stupid things, and they just constantly get hurt and constantly getting everybody in trouble instead of being scared as shit, as I would be. I'm sure at 12, I'd be freaking out. You know, if people were chasing me with guns and vans and trying to kidnap me a few times, and still by the end, she's like, I just want to go home. I don't want this over, but in the wrong possible way. In the most wrong possible way she does it. But that's the script, and that's not the girl. That's not the actor, that's not anything to do with that. That's just the script. This is produced by Jennifer Lopez, I'm pretty sure. At least she's one of the production companies. I'm not sure if that's an add-on because she just wants to be added on. That's part of her contractual obligation she demands. Or she actually fought for the script. I didn't look at the IMDb trivia stuff on it because I didn't want to. It runs about 2 hours. It feels a little bit longer. But as I said before, when you have an actor that is part of the producing team, executive producer, whatever, they're pushing the story, the narrative, it's hard to say no to them. It's hard to get them into a good spot where they're really an actor, in all honesty. It's really easy for people to just say yes, 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 yes. The more higher up the figure, guess what? They're going to get a lot of yeses. No one's going to tell them ever, don't do that. She's doing running scenes, physical scenes, fighting scenes, punching scenes, cursing scenes, screaming scenes. She rides a motorcycle like a badass, gets off the fight guides, but takes off her helmet, which makes no sense. She's wearing a peanut helmet. Helmet, she should keep it on. It's probably extra protection. Since she's in military, she's used to a helmet. Then she just, I mean, there's even a running scene. It's kind of like ridiculous it is. She tells Zoe, the daughter, to run as she's dealing with the bad guys. And then she goes after her with the motorcycle. And the girl is running as fast as the motorcycle. Like she's struggling to keep, the motorcycle is struggling to keep up with the girl. And that makes no sense. It just makes no sense. There's a couple things like that in this story. I think it's just bad writing. And they're just trying to do something, but maybe it's bad editing. I don't know. It's just, maybe there's things missing. That could be it too. They're just trying to do a very grand story that possibly could be a franchise. I don't see how it could be, but maybe. And they're just trying to push something that somebody wanted, and it's the wrong way to do it. Maybe she's tired of doing the romantic films. Maybe she's tired of being that character that she plays so often. And then this one, too, they're still showing off her looks, and they're emphasizing her body, and they're commenting on her body, and it's all that stuff. But she has like this pained look on her face the whole time, and I don't know if it's confusion or discomfort, uncertainty. I don't know what it is, but it's constant. It's constant. And my other peeve with the characters is that they're really not listening. It almost feels like they're just going through the script. And that's the notes they're hitting, and there's no listening, there's no thought process behind their heads. Even though she's like trying to get away from people. And then another thing too, one of the peeves that I have, well, actually I have a couple of them. So the snappy kid, I've mentioned this before, I can't stand kids in a life-friendly moment that are snappy and are obviously bringing, you know, danger upon everybody by being like a pain in the ass. And this doesn't get it, that you can't be a pain in the ass right now because people are trying to kill you, especially if people are chasing you in vans and people are dying around you and the kid is just being a pain in the ass. And that's just the way it's written. That I can't stand that. There's another thing where somebody buys a vehicle right away and drives away with it. Doesn't happen in this century. It might have happened in the 1920s, 30s, when registration really wasn't a thing. Inspections weren't a thing. People just swapped cars and stole cars. They're very expensive items. Nowadays, you can't just buy a car and drive it away, especially off the street. You can't say, here's $1,000, let me give you a car. They're going to give you a plate, you got nothing. I don't know where you're going with that car, but not very far. Bad guys are chasing Zoe. They don't know her handler, which she's been in the system for 12 years. They've found her to like literally a cross street in the middle of friggin' nowhere. And they just T-bone a car to get at her. They would know who's in that car with her, who's driving her. They would know everything about her to get to that level of chase. So there's problems with this film. It's not a great film at all. I don't think it's really good at all. It's not going to hold up. It's number one on Netflix this week, but you know, I don't know what those algorithms are doing. It's just not a good film. I would say pass it by unless you're part of her, you know, audience that like to see her do stuff. And she's okay. I'm not going to say she's doing a horrible job. I just think it's not a very good script, and no one had the courage to say no to Mother. There you go. That's my review. Subscribe, like, share, come back, tell me I'm wrong. I have no idea. Maybe I'm totally wrong. Maybe you can convince me. I don't think so. There's just too many little problems with this film. But if you want to talk about another film, pick a film. I'll do it. I don't know. I'll watch something. We'll talk about it. And maybe my ideas don't come across, and maybe they do. But all the best. Again, Roland DeRucci from Ready Speaker saying thank you and good night. Bye.